The Inimitable Jeeves, written by P.G. Wodehouse, narrated by J. David Corr. The Inimitable Jeeves by P.G. Wodehouse was first published in the United States in 1923, the same year that James P. Johnson released his recording of The Charleston, a song specifically composed to accompany the dance craze by the same name, which had swept the speakeasies of the Prohibition era. This song, as well as Wodehouse's stories, The Great Gatsby, Flappers, Gangsters, and Talking Pictures, have since come to epitomize the Roaring Twenties. At the time of their publication, copyright law in the United States lasted for 75 years, meaning those works would have entered the public domain 22 years ago. However, the law was changed 2 years before the end of the 20th century, such that works written prior to 1998 that were not already in the public domain would have an additional 21 years added to their copyright. Consequently, nothing from 1923 or after has entered the public domain for 20 years, until January 1st of the year of this audio production, 2019. This means that in the U.S., both The Charleston and The Inimitable Jeeves are available for the first time to share royalty-free. Wodehouse was born in Guildford, Surrey, in England, on October 15, 1881. He spent the first 2 years of his life in Hong Kong, where his father was a magistrate. At 2 years of age, he and his brothers were returned to England and were placed in the care of nannies on the maternal grandparents' estate, while their parents returned to China. Until the age of 18, Wodehouse was sent away to various boarding schools and spent holidays with any of his numerous aunts or uncles, several of whom were clergy. After school, Wodehouse began to write and within 2 years had published some 80 articles, some serious, some humorous, in a variety of magazines. He wrote for the theater as both a collaborator and a lyricist, but he is best known for his prolific output of comedic novels and for creating memorable characters such as Smith, Mulliner, Blandings, and of course, Bertrand Wooster and his valet Jeeves. He married a widow, Ethel May Wayman, in 1914 and adopted her daughter. He passed away on Valentine's Day of 1975 at the age of 93. In the course of his substantial life, P.G. Wodehouse was considered the toast of Broadway, a traitor to his homeland, a genius, a fool, and a person deserving of knighthood. He had been living in the north of France at the start of the Second World War and found himself a prisoner of the German government throughout the occupation. During this period, he was compelled to make 4 radio broadcasts entitled How to Be an Internee Without Previous Training, which were broadcast to an American audience in an effort by the Germans to dissuade U.S. involvement in the war. After the conflict had ended, British reaction to these broadcasts were mixed, but most considered them ill-advised at best to treasonous at worst. With no hope of returning to his homeland without being put on trial, he fled to the U.S. along with his wife, where they remained for the remainder of his life. However, shortly before his death in 1975, Wodehouse was formally forgiven, and the British government bestowed upon him the honorific of Cerebellum Grenville Wodehouse, Knight of the British Empire. Chapter 1. Jeeves Exerts the Old Cerebellum. "Morning, Jeeves," I said.
"Good morning, sir," said Jeeves.
He put the old cup of tea softly on the table by my bed, and I took a refreshing sip. Just right, as usual. Not too hot, not too sweet, not too weak, not too strong, not too much milk, and not a drop spilled in the saucer. A most amazing cove, Jeeves, so dashed competent in every respect. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. I mean to say, take just one small instance. Every other valet I've ever had used to barge into my room in the morning while I was still asleep, causing much misery. But Jeeves seems to know when I'm awake by a sort of telepathy. He always floats in with a cup exactly 2 minutes after I come to life. Makes a deuce of a lot of difference in a fellow's day. How's the weather, Jeeves?"
"Exceptionally clement, sir."
"Anything in the papers?"
"Some slight friction threatening in the Balkans, sir. Otherwise nothing."
"I say, Jeeves, a man I met at the club last night told me to put my shirt on privateer for the 2 o'clock race this afternoon. How about it?"
"I should not advocate it, sir. The stable is not sanguine."
That was enough for me. Jeeves knows. How, I couldn't say, but he knows. There was a time when I would laugh lightly and go ahead and lose my little all against his advice, but not now. "Talking of shirts," I said, "have those mauve ones I ordered arrived yet?"
"Yes, sir. I sent them back."
"Sent them back?"
"Yes, sir. They would not have become you."
"Well, I must say I'd thought fairly highly of those shirtings, but I bowed to superior knowledge.
Weak? I don't know. Most fellows, no doubt, are all for having their valets confine their activities to creasing trousers and whatnot without trying to run the home. But it's different with Jeeves. Right from the first day he came to me, I have looked on him as a sort of guide, philosopher, and friend.
Mr. Little rang up on the telephone a few moments ago, sir. I informed him that you were not yet awake.
Did he leave a message?
No, sir. He mentioned that he had a matter of importance to discuss with you, but confided no details.
Oh, well, I expect I shall be seeing him at the club.
No doubt, sir.
I wasn't what you call in a fever of impatience. Bingo Little is a chap I was at school with, and we see a lot of each other still. He's the nephew of old Mortimer Little, who retired from business recently with a goodish pile. You've probably heard of Little's liniment. It limbers up the legs. Bingo biffs about London on a pretty comfortable allowance given him by his uncle, and leads, on the whole, a fairly unclouded life. It wasn't likely that anything which he described as a matter of importance would turn out to be really so frightfully important. I took it that he had discovered some new brand of cigarette which he wanted me to try, or something like that, and didn't spoil my breakfast by worrying. After breakfast, I lit a cigarette and went to the open window to inspect the day. It certainly was one of the best and brightest. "Jeeves," I said.
"Sir?"
said Jeeves. He had been clearing away the breakfast things, but at the sound of the young master's voice, cheesed it courteously. "You were absolutely right about the weather. It is a juicy morning."
"Decidedly, sir."
"Spring and all that."
"Yes, sir."
"In the spring, Jeeves, a livelier iris gleams upon the burnished dove."
"So I have been informed, sir."
"Righto. Then bring me my wangie, my yellowish shoes, and the old green Homburg. I am going into the park to do pastoral dances." I don't know if you know the sort of feeling you get on these days, round about the end of April and the beginning of May, when the sky's a light blue, with cotton-wool clouds, and there's a bit of a breeze blowing from the west. Kind of uplifted feeling, romantic if you know what I mean. I'm not much of a ladies' man, but on this particular morning it seemed to me that what I really wanted was some charming girl to buzz up and ask me to save her from assassins or something, so that it was a bit of an anticlimax when I merely ran into young Bingo Little, looking perfectly foul in a crimson satin tie decorated with horseshoes.
"Hello, Bertie," said Bingo.
"My God, man," I gargled. "The cravat, the gent's neckwear. Why? For what reason?"
"Oh, the tie," he blushed. I was given it."
He seemed embarrassed, so I dropped the subject. We toddled along a bit and sat down on a couple of chairs by the serpentine. "Jeeves tells me you want to talk to me about something," I said. "Eh?" said Bingo with a start.
"Oh, yes, yes, yes."
I waited for him to unleash the topic of the day, but he didn't seem to want to get going. Conversation languished. He stared straight ahead of him in a glassy sort of manner.
I say, Bertie," he said, after a pause of about an hour and a quarter.
"Hello?
Do you like the name Mabel?"
"No."
"No?
No.
You don't think there's a kind of music in the word, like the wind rustling gently through the treetops?"
"No."
He seemed disappointed for a moment, then cheered up. "Of course you wouldn't. You always were a fat-headed worm without a soul, weren't you?"
"Just as you say. Who is she? Tell me all." For I realize now that poor old Bingo was going through it once again. Ever since I have known him, and we were at school together, he has been perpetually falling in love with someone, generally in the spring, which seems to act on him like magic. At school he had the finest collection of actresses' photographs of anyone of his time, and at Oxford his romantic nature was a byword.
"You'd better come along and meet her at lunch," he said, looking at his watch.
"A ripe suggestion," I said. "Where are you meeting her?"
"At the Ritz."
"Near the Ritz." He was geographically accurate. About 50 yards east of the Ritz, there is one of those blighted tea and bun shops you see dotted about all over London. And into this, if you'll believe me, young Bingo dived like a homing rabbit, and before I had time to say a word, we were wedged in at a table, on the brink of a silent pool of coffee left there by an early luncher. I'm bound to say I couldn't quite follow the development of the scenario. Bingo, while not absolutely rolling in this stuff, has always had a fair amount of the ready. Apart from what he got from his uncle, I knew that he had finished up the jumping season well on the right side of the ledger. Why, then, was he lunching the girl at this godforsaken eatery?
It couldn't be because he was hard up. Just then the waitress arrived, rather a pretty girl. "Aren't we going to wait?" I started to say to Bingo, thinking it somewhat thick that, in addition to asking a girl to lunch with him in a place like this, he should fling himself on the foodstuffs before she turned up, when I caught sight of his face and stopped. The man was goggling. His entire map was suffused with a red blush. He looked like the soul's awakening done in pink. "Hello, Mabel," he said with a sort of gulp.
"Hello," said the girl.
"Mabel," said Bingo, "this is Bertie Wooster, a pal of mine."
"Pleased to meet you," she said. "Nice morning."
"Fine," I said.
"You see, I'm wearing the tie," said Bingo. "It suits you beautiful," said the girl.
Personally, if anyone had told me that a tie like that suited me, I should have risen and struck them on the mazzard, regardless of their age and sex. But poor old Bingo simply got all flustered with gratification and smirked in the most gruesome manner.
"Well, what's it going to be today?"
asked the girl, introducing the business touch into the conversation. Bingo studied the menu devoutly.
"I'll have a cup of cocoa, cold veal and ham pie, slice of fruitcake and a macaroon. Same for you, Bertie?"
I gazed at the man revolted. That he could have been a pal of mine all these years and think me capable of insulting the old Tom with this sort of stuff cut me to the quick.
"Or how about a bit of hot steak pudding with a sparkling limado to wash it down?" said Bingo.
You know, the way love can change a fellow is really frightful to contemplate. This chappie before me, who spoke in that absolutely careless way of macaroons and limado, was a man I had seen in happier days telling the head waiter at Claridge's exactly how he wanted the chef to prepare the sole frite au gourmet au champignon, and saying he would jolly well sling it back if it wasn't just right. Ghastly. Ghastly. A roll in butter and a small coffee seemed the only things on the list that hadn't been specially prepared by the nastier-minded members of the Borgia family for people they had a particular grudge against. So I chose them, and Mabel hopped it.
"Well," said Bingo rapturously.
I took it that he wanted my opinion of the female poisoner who had just left us.
"Very nice," I said.
He seemed dissatisfied.
"You don't think she's the most wonderful girl you ever saw?" he said wistfully.
"Oh, absolutely," I said to appease the blighter. "Where did you meet her?"
"At a subscription dance in Camberwell."
"What on earth were you doing at a subscription dance at Camberwell?"
"Your man Jeeves asked me if I would buy a couple of tickets. It was in aid of some charity or other."
"Jeeves? I didn't know he went in for that sort of thing."
"Well, I suppose he has to relax a bit every now and then. Anyway, he was there, swinging a dashed efficient shoe. I hadn't meant to go at first, but I turned up for a lark. Oh, Bertie, think what I might have missed."
"What might you have missed?" I asked, the old lemon being slightly clouded.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.